health is everyone's business. It is not just sick women's business. Women's mental health is not a priority in Australia. It is not on the top of anyone's to-do list in terms of agendas. It is under-resourced in many, many ways. And investing in women's mental health is actually an investment for everybody. You will know a lot of these stats, so I'm sorry to bore you a bit with it, but we just so that we know we're starting from the same base. In Australia in 2007, this is good data from the Australian Institute of Health and Welfare, 43% of women, that's 3.5 million, had experienced mental illness of some sort at some time in their lives. Australian women are more likely than men to have experienced symptoms of a mental disorder during the previous 12 months. That's 22% of the female population, compared to 18% of men. And of these conditions, anxiety disorders, 18% of women compared to 11% of men, affective disorders, 7% of women compared to 5%, eating disorders affect more women than men, and deliberate self-harm has been estimated by the AIHW as 20 times increased rates in women than men. So that's quite a significant change. Now, I'm not by any means trying to make out that men don't suffer. There is a whole range of alcohol and drug data that I can produce for you, and early psychosis and so on. But this is to make the point that the genders are different. The way women and men experience mental illness is different. The numbers are different. And the sorts of treatments and illness understandings, therefore, need to be different. At the moment, they're not. We know about the obvious ones, which is post-childbirth, and also in my work we're looking at menopausal women as well. But that's not enough, because it's the standard mainstream mental illnesses, if you like, and the standard mainstream comorbid illnesses that women experience differently, and therefore need to have a different look at how to go about managing this. I did mention drug and alcohol abuse, and everybody focuses importantly on young men who do have increasing rates of drug and alcohol abuse. But I would draw your attention from this survey to this other group here. Between the 45 to 54-year-old women and 55 to 64-year-old women, you'll see that there's quite a high incidence, not as high as the males, but you see this increase here and here compared to the 25 to 34-year-old women. That's a disturbing trend, and it is something that we see in clinical practice all the time, that it is the middle-aged women who are increasingly taking up alcohol, particularly wines. And amongst health professionals, and we're very concerned about what's happening in the nursing profession and the allied health professionals, that in fact there is an increase, a sharp increase, in the alcohol consumed. And in speaking to nurses groups, with the College of Nursing, etc., that we're doing some work there, you get disturbed by some of the comments, which is, oh, well, yes, it's quite common that I will go home from a shift and I'll have a couple of red wines, maybe three red wines, but it's the good stuff I'm drinking, so therefore it's not harmful. You know, things like that really do suggest to us that we do have to look at what is going on in our female population, that these are trends that have changed importantly over the years. So, mental health clearly is gendered, just like physical health is gendered. We do know that men and women have different patterns of illness and other forms of mental distress, and they're exposed to different risk factors and vulnerabilities. There have been a number of theories as to why are women more prone to anxiety disorders, particularly post-traumatic stress disorder than other sorts of disorders. And the differences in terms of the theories really come into pretty basic possibilities, that it's to do with biological theories, or personality of women compared to men, or the psychological theories, or it's to do with social theories. And really the answer lies in all of the above, and a combination of all of the above, and the interactions between all of them, which is exactly why I'm really pushing for a biopsychosocial approach to urgently integrate the issues that people are experiencing so that we can produce a better tailored package of treatments. So what are the causes? Well, we know in the biology that certain psychiatric illnesses are only seen as women, such as postpartum disorders, but we haven't really followed that up. Now, we know this, but then where are the understanding of the hormone impact? That's what's going on in pregnancy. Huge, massive hormone shifts, along with other different conceptual shifts about responsibilities and roles and other things. But there's a massive change in hormones, it's obvious. And yet, we haven't really got to mainstream treatments, which takes all that information and observation and turns it into something that's useful. Psychological issues. Psychiatric illnesses do present differently in men and women because of the gender differences in psychological responses and defences as well, and coping styles and strategies. And then we have a whole lot of social issues, and in particular one of my beefs, and again it's a whole other 3-hour talk here, is about the label of borderline personality disorder. I absolutely abhor that title, and I think we're doing a lot of people a lot of disservice by using that term, not defining what it is that we're actually treating and not looking at some of the issues there, which I'll talk a little bit about. So, we need to think about the headings as headings, but in actual fact it's combinations of all of this. It is hormones, it is, and other biological factors, it is self-esteem and psychological factors, it is violence and alcohol and drugs. You can't just say, let's just pick one thing and work with that. And I think the biological area is one area that's really behind. I'm about to organise I'm organising a conference on the 19th of August at Monash University called Innovating Psychiatry Through Neuroscience. The neuroscientists and the people in other medical specialties have gone streets ahead of where we're at in psychiatry. If you think about it, through research, a kid who is diagnosed with leukemia, a woman who's diagnosed with breast cancer, the prognosis is so much better than it was when I was a medical student 300 years ago. But, you know, the prognosis is, in terms of schizophrenia, we've made some headway, but we haven't got to that golden standard, you know, where we can talk about cures. You know, we don't even think in that sort of framework. And yet, the neuroscience of the things that are going on in terms of stem cell input into treating MS, multiple sclerosis, there's a program of treating MS with stem cells with good results. Now, this is a sort of science fiction thing that I would have dreamed about when I was a student. Yeah, I was pretty boring as a student. But, you know, we balk at thinking about innovation to that level in depression or innovations in schizophrenia and you know, certainly with borderline personality disorder, we can't even get the name to make sense to our consumers. So, you know, it's really a long way behind. And people go, well, it's the brain, you know, the brain's complicated. But again, I put it to you that motor neuron disease has made great advances, MS has made great advances, stroke. You know, there are studies now looking at, and there are actual inhuman studies looking at re-engineering and growing brain tissue that's been damaged by stroke. So these are all conditions that are in the brain as well. So what the hell are we doing? You know, why are we so far behind? Anyway, so hopefully, as we start to sort of learn from our colleagues in other areas, we can improve some of these issues. But certainly the biology is one that I'm really concerned about, as I am about some of the other things, as you are as well, I'm sure. Environment. Now, I know we were very fortunate to have Rosie Batty talking here yesterday. I'm sorry, I missed her speech. I've caught it in other areas. But she certainly is a great advocate about violence against women. And you know these facts. You know, these are data now that have come out time and time again from very reputable sources after very reputable work that's been done. And they're awful statistics. They really are horrible statistics. I also get very annoyed when people go, oh, well, you know, these statistics are all about the reporting that's improved and increased now. It's not that the actual violence against women is increasing. It's the fact that it's being reported more. No, you know, it doesn't matter. That's an academic semantic situation. The fact that we know that well over one third of women, 40%, had experienced physical and or sexual violence is appalling. Whether that is a reporting or has it increased, the fact is that is what we know is happening today. And it's unacceptable, as Rosie will have talked about. The other issue that always comes about is that, you know, men get assaulted. Yes, they do, and that's awful. But predominantly, the figures show that women are more the victims of assault. And certainly the treatment modalities haven't really crossed from thinking about the trauma that women have experienced. How is that impacting on her mental health? What is going on in her admission to hospital? Why does she self-harm? And why don't we know that the self-harming is related to the fact that there's an abusive situation that she's not coping with, but is thrust into at home? We very rarely as mental health clinicians, put the two together in our current acute services. And that's really important that we start to do some of this work. And again, I won't go through all these figures because they're very, very common, commonly known. But maybe this one is another important area that perhaps needs a little bit more focus, which is about antenatal domestic violence. You would think that it would be the other way around, that in fact domestic violence decreases when the woman is pregnant. In fact, it's the other way. There are increased reports of domestic violence in the antenatal or assaults on the pregnant woman. And that is unfortunately a feature that is seen in many other countries as well. There's a big study, the Avon study, which currently has 14,451 pregnancies that have been studied and followed. And the longitudinal data from that study shows that behavioural problems are seen in the child whose mother was abused during pregnancy up to 4 years. It's not that it gets better after 4 years, it's just that's where the current data is at. Now, with a pregnant woman who is the victim of violence during pregnancy, there are several things that happen at a psychological level, no doubt, and social level, if she's got financial issues and so on, but at a biological level, there is a rapid shift in her cortisol, which is the adrenal axis, which is the fight or flight, one of the fight or flight hormones. There is a change in that metabolism. Understand that she's under stress, it's awful, and this is what her body does. That then impacts on the fetal brain. The developing fetal brain absorbs this change in the stress hormones and actually then develops into a disordered stress response in the developing baby. So you can see that what's going on is even without the maternal then, you know, depression, which you would imagine very well be there because of what she's dealing with, that even without that, there is an issue that this unborn child and later on this young baby and child will have to cope with. So again, I come back to some of the things that we know now about stress and hormones in women. Children who have been in the situation being stressed by either viewing domestic violence or being in a household where there is a whole lot of stress because of the violence and because of other abuse situations, and this is emotional abuse as well as emotional deprivation, which is a form of abuse as well as physical and sexual, can actually have difficulties in their cortisol and HPA or hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis, which then impacts on their hard wiring of their brain. So there are actual changes in their learning capacity, attention and anxiety, which is a biological program of change. It can be overcome. It's not, this is, you know, forget about it, but you can't do anything. But it means that this child is starting at a different base when they're going to school. Girls with sexual abuse history often later identify with self-harm, with high anxiety, with unstable self-identity, with mood swings, and can have transient psychotic symptoms. So what am I describing there? A very well-known syndrome, but the sequelae of heightened sensitivity. So imagine this is a fetus, then baby, then child, who is heightened to not cope with stresses that others may cope with. So little things can become hugely stressful because the whole brain hardwiring and stress axis is altered right from the very body. And what sort of stresses do these girls then, who become women, cope with? Well, often they cope with more violence and gender-based violence, abusive relationships, financial difficulties, migration, all in one bag, are actually significant environmental stresses, which can lead to physical and mental ill health, as we know. A not well-known aspect about all of this is that if you alter the cortisol mechanisms from early life, you actually also have a flow-on effect to other hormone systems. And one of those other hormone systems is the obesity regulation. So the capacity to regulate weight, and particularly with waist circumference and high BMIs, is often seen in this group. There is also a problem with ischemic heart disease because of coronary artery plaques and calcification happening at an earlier age. There is also the lower SHBG, which is sex hormone binding globulin, which can actually lead to infertility and increased rates of a syndrome called polycystic ovarian syndrome. So my point to make here is you've got stress in the mum, which can be transmitted to this unborn child, which then gets into a brain change in hardwiring and various hormone flow-ons that can lead to both physical problems, with obesity, with heart disease, with polycystic ovarian syndrome, infertility, as well as the problems that I just mentioned, which are the features of what we know as borderline personality disorder. Why does this happen more in women? Because there's always this comment that, you know, again, you know, the child could be a male child, and certainly the same sort of cortisol effect of the mum does get transmitted to the male child, but there is a different diathesis between the stress hormone axis and the female hormone axis. And I won't bore you to tears with it all, but, you know, this has been subject of work that we've been doing for some time. But it is a much more significant problem for girls, women. And therefore, some of the stresses that are experienced, like sexual abuse, emotional deprivation, physical deprivation, have a greater emotional and physical impact based on a biological basis before you even start thinking about the psychological mechanisms. But of course, they have a role to play as well. Now, there is a reported increasing rate of sexual abuse of Australian girls. So again, from ABS data 2011, so it's not talking about older data here, there is a greater number of early to mid-teenage girls with incidence of maltreatment, sexual abuse, physical and violence and neglect. Now, again, we come back to that. Is it more reporting or is it increasing? Whatever it is, we need to be aware of the fact that it's going to have a long-lasting impact in terms of a number of those effects that I've just outlined. So, again, the other thing that's been found in animal studies and earlier studies, the FLASH study and so on, is that the cortisol changes are also linked to the serotonin transporter gene. So the serotonin transporter gene is an important gene that actually regulates the serotonin production, which we all know is very important in depression. So again, my concern is if we don't get on top of this, we're actually sitting on the beginnings of, you know, increasing levels of depression and other mental disorders in the forthcoming populations. So this isn't just today's problem, this is tomorrow and the day after's problem as well. Borderline PD, hate the term. But what we are seeing is with a correlation of high rates of abuse that is leading to stress in girls, that we're seeing increased mental ill health in women, as girls becoming women. It's a badly named, poorly understood, and even more poorly treated for condition. So we work very closely with Spectrum, who are a wonderful organisation, and obviously there's other many key workers in the area, but one of the things that there's people from Spectrum and we have complain about, and the consumers rightly complain about, is this term, borderline personality disorder. Yes, it's in the DSM-5, but what a useless term. If you say something is borderline, you're basically saying, does it exist, does it not exist? It's different, you know, in terms of the actual history of this term. Yes, it was borderline psychosis and neurosis with the original Gunderson term in 1952, but it's got lost. And it's also got stigmatized, very heavily stigmatized. So a number of people who get this term sort of saying things like, well, you know, do I have a problem or not because it's borderline? And then the second part of it is personality disorder. You're telling me that the essence of the thing that makes up an individual human being, personality, is disordered. That's a terrible message to give someone. It really is, because it's like saying you as a human being are stuffed, disordered, useless, etc. So in Spectrum, and also, you know, someone put out an article recently in the conversation, really great feedback actually, that complex trauma disorder or chronic trauma disorder is a better term. The other reason for that is because it links the trauma. Unfortunately, mental health clinicians, general health clinicians are not great at getting the trauma history. And the woman who's got the trauma history is not great at giving that history either. Because, you know, she's turned up to ED having taken a paracetamol overdose because she's angry with the perpetrator that you may find out after therapy for 2 years, because that, there's a trust issue and all the rest that goes on. But there is a link. And if we think about chronic or complex trauma disorder, we take the onus off the person as being personality disordered and just, you know, kind of useless, and if you just pull up socks and get on with it, you'll be better. And that tends to make her also think more about the trauma aspects of things, and we have a way forward. I was on the DSM-5 working party and got thrown off it because of what I was trying to suggest in terms of this. And the rationale for why the DSM-5 didn't want to include this in their post-traumatic stress disorder or their trauma group was because of the Veterans Affairs, the American Veterans Association, which is a very, very powerful lobby group. And so they were very clear, and in fact the conversations got quite ugly. They said, you know, we're not going to pollute our veterans with this group. These are people who are just, you know, harming themselves. It's not what our veterans do, etc. So the whole sort of trauma, the battle got a bit lost there. But certainly there's quite a lot of consumer support. There's also carer support. There's also a lot of clinician support for this change in the terminology, even if it's an informal change. Even if we talk about, okay, a diagnosis. Sometimes people don't give people, women, diagnosis of borderline personality disorder because you sort of feel like, you know, it's got a stigma and it's you're trying to tell someone they have a personality disorder. It's pretty awful. But you can follow it up by saying, this would be the official term, but unofficially, we reckon it's complex trauma disorder, and you may not want to talk about the trauma right now, but you know, we do understand that things have been tough for you. Definition of trauma is very big as well. It's not just about sexual and physical violence, it's all sorts of things. It starts a dialogue, and it starts a validation, which is a problem with this group, the invalidation. So I won't go through all this, this all is absolutely on top of it, but just remember that there will be there may well be physical responses and symptoms associated with this condition. So we're working at the moment, looking at the relationship further between the abuse stress and complex trauma disorder to actually sort of typify the sorts of symptoms. We have a sense that the more severe the trauma, the more severe the condition in terms of self-harm and the other things that go along with that. Okay. I would like to talk a little bit more about the other environmental stresses for women, which includes early sexualisation of girls and mental illness, financial stresses, and leadership culture for women. Now, precocious sexualisation. This is a picture of a four-year-old from a beauty competition called Toddlers and Tiaras. This is Miley Cyrus, who was age 9 at the time. Our society is increasingly precociously sexualising our girls to a big extent, boys to some extent as well, but much more about the precocious sexualization of girls as sex objects. So at age 4, you've got this kid who's got hair extensions, fake teeth, spray tan, wearing a stripper outfit, fake eyelashes and so on. You've got Miley Cyrus in there, who's very sort of sexually promiscuous, or sort of, you know, sexualized outfit at age 9. And it is something that is certainly an issue in terms of what impact does this have. Precocious or premature sexualisation is related to mental health problems like eating disorders, low self-esteem, depression and so on. It does put girls in danger because of the message that this is what she is, and there's less to her other than just the fact that she's a sex object, which again can lead to early abuse stories, an increased sexual contact that is unwanted. And these are still children who mentally don't have the capacity to be in charge of her own sexuality until she's older. So again, this is some of the work that the Women's Forum Australia and the Australian Women's Health Network is trying to look at in much more detail, but we do know that the early sexualisation of girls is linked to mental disorders. I'm going to skate across a lot of them. All these are big areas, but I just want to give you some overviews as to where we see things happening for women at the moment. Financial status. You remember all the equal pay, very strident work that was done in the 70s by the feminist movement. Well, unfortunately, the gender pay gap has increased between 2004 and 2012. I don't have the current data, but I'll show you some other figures. And women are earning considerably less as a group than men. The gender pay gap in February 2012 stood at 17.4%. So 17.4% less salary for the average weekly earnings of women. Obviously, there is a part-time or sessional wage that is more commonly seen in women, but even taking that into account, there is still a gender pay difference. And it's in fact worse in the private sector, where the gap is even more. The ANZ, I don't know how long this has come out, but the ANZ just put out a paper only a month ago, and they calculated that on average women earn in a lifetime $700,000 less during their entire lifetime. That's quite a huge gap. When women retire, they are often 50% less superannuation savings than men, and on average $92,000 worse off. So you can see that even with the equal female university graduates, so equal education, that there is still a pay difference. Now, this is important because money talks, money is power, money is influence, and it's not the only thing, but you know, it has legs. So this is another whole area where there is some concern. Also, the fact that only 31% of all federal, state, and territory parliamentarians are women is of very great concern. And we know about the situation in federal cabinet and female representation. It's pathetic. So that's just a summary of the ANZ study. And they did take into account the female full-time workers, rather than saying, of course they're going to get paid less because women take time out for families, but even including that, women are still being paid 18.8% less than men. Sexism and mental health is another important area. Just like Nazim in his very humorous way talked about some of the feelings that people have belonging to a minority group, sexism and mental health is alive and well. This is a very sad situation for us in a public hospital, and like many other public hospitals, and like in the health profession. This is an article from August 10th, so a couple of days ago. It's about sexism in the medical workplace. Well, Australia's medical profession is failing to stand out sexual harassment, bullying, and discrimination of women. And there have been many stories that have been increasingly unfolding. You've seen the various reports and so on. I raise this because this is us. This is our backyard. We can't comfortably stand back and go, oh yes, you know, we know about sexism out there in the boardrooms or whatever it is. This is us. So again, I would urge us all, and again, I would go back to my first statement, women's mental health is everyone's business. This isn't about just women coming out or being responsible to stand up, although we should stand up for colleagues who we think are being bullied or whatever. This is about everybody, about not allowing bullying and discrimination. We can step in and do something, because it's only going to be from the ground up that we can do some of this. I urge you to read this particular article that was in the NJA recently. Sexism in politics. I put this rather devastating cartoon up, and it doesn't matter which side of the political fence you fall on or you believe. This was a terrible cartoon that was depicting Julia Gillard when she was Prime Minister. So if you can depict a Prime Minister as wearing a dildo, and you know, similarly with Senator Penny Wong, and these are women, you know, powerful women with power, with a significant responsible role in this way, it really has sent a terrible message to younger women coming up through the ranks. Why would younger women want to go into politics if this is what's going to happen to them? And as I say, go to the other side of the fence, the Peter Credlin attacks and so on. I mean, it doesn't matter whether you think these people are good at their jobs or they've stuffed up or whatever it is. The sexual attacks are much more commonly directed at women, and therefore they should be unacceptable to us all. Sexism in sport. Sexism in sport is a really big problem because it excludes women from one of Australia's most important cultural products. Australia prides itself on sports. So excluding women or having less coverage of women's sports or being less prestigious is a really important and significant thing that we should take a stand against, because it has an impact on mental health. Decline of sports coverage in the ABC, I was really disappointed, this is again updated on the 13th of April, that the ABC, because of their funding cuts, one of the first things they've done is they've cut their coverage of women's sports. So again, you know, it's important to tackle this as a social issue. For us in the mental health area, it has significant impacts on the mental health of our women patients and of women in the field. I was quite stunned when I saw this. Yes, the Australian cricket team had complete chaos and disaster in their recent Ashes loss. But one of the things that came out was Ian Healy saying that it was the wives and girlfriends who were distracting the Test cricketers, and that's why they put in this performance where you think, you know, did they actually know what a cricket bat again? Again, it's still there. It's like, if something goes wrong, blame the women. So I put this up there as recent forms of descriptions of psychological factors. Self-esteem in women is really important, because poor self-esteem is linked to depression, anxiety disorders, and this is something that is seen much more commonly generally in women. The fraud syndrome, it's not a real syndrome, but you know, it's a syndrome where women who are even very powerful, very confident seeming women, still have this sense of being fraud. I won't tell you who it is, but a very prominent board corporate woman who I was fortunate to have contact with gave a brilliant speech and came back down and was sitting next to me and she goes, did you think that's all right? Now, it's that sense of, it's great that, you know, there's not this overbearing sort of narcissistic, I'm fantastic, but at the same time, it can eke away at the self-esteem. Many, many great women will go away and sort of think, I only got the job because somebody better didn't apply, they're going to find out that I'm a fraud, etc., etc., I'm not really worth it, and so on. This leads to this concept of rumination, which is a very much more common female attribute of lying awake, worrying about things that have happened, things that are done. I'm not saying this doesn't happen in men as well, but it isn't. It's more dominant in females. The stress of appearance and performance is also something that many women have described. Men do as well. If you haven't seen Tracy Spicer's TED Talk, please go and have a look at it. Tracy Spicer, as you know, is a media woman, and she gave this interesting TED Talk where, as she was speaking, she started to peel off the makeup and then she wet her hair, and she talked about the problems that women have in the sense of performance and appearance. And she described herself as spending about $200 per week on cosmetics. When she actually unpeeled herself to look more like herself, she was threatened, her job was threatened, that she was not going to be reappointed as a Channel 10 media anchor, because this is how she was supposed to look. She's actually quite a well-credentialed journalist has done a lot in this area. So do go and have a look at this, because she does highlight the issue of performance and appearance stress. And many women describe the performance and appearance stress. So do many men as well. But it's another factor that's creeping up in terms of creating poor self-esteem and creating difficulties for being happy in oneself. Biological factors, and again, this is an area of research that I can go on for hours and hours, but I won't, what time am I finishing? I won't stress too much, but I just want to raise some of these issues which are specific conditions that women experience that, again, we're not teaching very well out there in our mental health disciplines. PMS, PMDD are different. Premenstrual dysphoric disorder is a significant depression that occurs for women in the childbearing age. The difficulty is it doesn't naturally just appear 1 week before menstrual period. It can occur 1 week in a month because the cycle can be very variable. But when you get that on-off depression that some women do describe, and and they actually describe with a click, you know, the moon just vomits, and they feel, you know, really angry, terrible, depressed, and then like that, it comes back on again. You've got to think of different treatment modalities because it is not the standard depressive illness. Perimenopausal depression, 16 times increased rate of depression in the 48 to 54 year olds women. And we think this is very clearly related to menopause. Everyone focuses on hot flushes, but in fact the depression in this period of time is very significant and doesn't respond to our usual treatments. So this is when women are being treated with the usual SSRIs or other antidepressants and not making a response. And then you've got the dual problem, because then you've got all the side effects of the medication and we spend a lot of time having to wind that back, and that's difficult. Whereas a hormone treatment is actually much more effective. Menopause is not taught anywhere in the medical curriculum at Monash, nor is it taught anywhere in the medical curriculum at Melbourne University, nor is it taught in Sydney University, because I had to go and look up these things. So I routinely ask my fourth year students, what do they know about menopause? And I get dead silence, or at best, like yesterday when I had the tube, Monday when I had the tube, the boy put up his hand and he said, I think my mum went through it, but I'm not sure. it's a really, if you think about it, how is it possible every woman goes through menopause? Not to medicalise it, but many, many women experience significant mental illness aspects, mental health changes. And it's a 10-year process. Hormonally, it's a 10-year process. It's not gone, you know, here today, gone tomorrow. And yet, it's a bit of an elephant in the room. My good friend Janet Michelmore, who runs the Jean Hales Foundation, which is devoted to women's health, has just put out a whole bunch of pink rubber elephants to emphasise the elephant in the room. So again, there are really important things. Late onset borderline, and I hate that term, but we see a number of women who've had those awful borderline symptoms in their younger years, kind of goes into stability, and then this erupts, the anger, the self-harm, erupts again at around mid-40s. So we have another issue of another condition that we don't really often pick, we don't label, we don't really get to grips with in terms of helping through. Psychosis relapse related to hormones, related to menopause, related to postnatal, very, very important. A whole area that we haven't paid a lot of specific attention to, and I'm going to finish soon so we can wrap up. But depression and the pill. The oral contraceptive pill is a very, very useful, obviously used by millions of women, control of reproduction, and yet there are many depressive side effects to many of the pills that are out there on the market. And we're currently wrapping up our fourth study, looking at the types of pills and the impact. Implanon, which is the straw that's a progesterone-only contraceptive, long-acting, has one of the worst rates of depression associated with it. And so these are the sorts of things that, you know, if you think about what are we doing with women's mental health, when we focus with the gender perspective, these issues come forward. And that means that we can actually look, and I could give a similar talk, perhaps not talking about PMS and PMDD in men, but you know, we could talk about a whole bunch of other issues that specifically affect men's health. Because gender is a really important way of thinking about the differences and how we can then integrate a lot of the theories, a lot of the psychosocial and biological approaches, so we can provide a brand new approach to many, many of the mental illnesses that many, many women are experiencing and not being able to get over. Because really, in the end, you know, women's mental health is everybody's business. Thank you.
Does anyone have any questions for Jayashree? Because she raised so many issues. We could take one or two if you do have some questions. She's going to be leaving us before we go to afternoon tea.
I'd just like to comment on the last slide, talking about the menopause and how you don't like to tell people about depression, but the cure for menopause and the hysteria that went through it traditionally was a hysterectomy. And we don't have to look at that either and how incorrect that is as a term.
Yeah, All I'm trying to do is get across the message that for that person who's been stable, and you know, we see many women who have no mental ill health in their lives and everything else is going on okay, but suddenly she developed quite a major depressive episode with anxiety. One of the key features is a very high level of anxiety, and it's not responding to certain treatments. And the missing discussion is that link between mental ill health and a biological process. And so the more we can integrate, and this has come back to my plea for let's learn about joining body and mind environment so that then we can actually provide better total care.
Thank you. Just one last question.
Hi, Dashi. Thank you very much for your talk. Just to emphasise on that medical part of psychiatry, as a trainee in psychiatry, I must say that we do get a lot on emphasise in our exams, for example, in like postpartum depression in men or borderline personality in women, but we don't frequently come with cases with menopause in women, do we, Steve, as an examiner, would you say?
Well, as I said, it's not even in any of the curriculum. And again, some work that we've done in College of Nursing, when we talk about this, they say, well, we have a big problem because we're losing some of our senior nursing staff because of their depression. And it's not a link that's clearly made for the women. You know, it's like there's this sort of digging into, okay, it's a relationship or it's this or that or the other. Yeah, I mean, sure. People always have stuff going on, but at 45, most women have got it together in terms of, you know, managing the day-to-day stress, and then suddenly this comes as a big ball of work. And this is affecting our middle managers, our layer of executives, and so on. And it's not a good setup for healthy ageing to go on.
Okay, we'll not leave it there, thank you. And Jeshri, you said you had 300 years of experience in psychiatry. I heard that. I think your research output sort of fills that you had. You know, like that, but one thing I want to compliment you on is the research that you do is very practical and through practical applications for clinical practice and for the multidisciplinary teams. That's wonderful stuff. Thank you very much for your It's a tree. I hope she hasn't got a house as small as mine. I think my tree's going to take over the whole of Fitzroy. I'm really worried about that. Particularly with the cost of land these days. Now we're going to have an afternoon tea break. So we come back in about 15 minutes. And then we have a panel. We have some questions. We've gone to the panel discussion.